let's get into the introduction. Cannibalism is defined as the predation of conspecific organism and is seen in many different taxons, but this is mostly prevalent among the members of arthropods, in particular the Lepidoptera family member. In Lepidoptera family members, the cannibalism is a tendency that is shown from the larval stage, and it usually grows as the larva grows bigger. In particular, it has been noted that the sixth instar in caterpillars, that is the stage before, right before they go into pupation, is when the caterpillars are most cannibalistic. Fall armyworm, also the scientific order, is an extremely common pest and noted for its massive economic impact all across the globe. This is a native to the Americas, in particular the South America and the North America, but since then has spread all over Asia and Africa. Right now, this is considered to be responsible for causing up to 30% of corn production losses in African countries. And that is in spite of all the insecticides that have been used to counter this. Recently, it has also been considered to be a serious pest in India and Nepal. This feeds on mostly grass type of plants, including rice, corn, barley, so on. This is unique in a sense because this is a generalist caterpillar which allows it to feed on a broad range of host plants, but exposes it to a wide range of plant-induced defensive compounds. We will be using two of the most common compounds that this caterpillar encounters. Those are nicotine and trypsin inhibitor. The objective of my research was to study how cannibalistic behavior among the fall armyworm larva was influenced by plant-induced defensive, in particular trypsin inhibitor and nicotine. And the second objective was to study if cannibalism provided some kind of compensatory benefit to the caterpillars by regulating digestive gene expression. I hypothesized that because caterpillars who cannibalized each other avoided the worst of the plant defenses, it will provide them some benefit by giving access to a highly rich nutrient source. Let's go into the background about cannibalism a little bit. The earliest mention of cannibalism in herbivore caterpillars that I could find was in 1749. It was noticed in Charlica delphini, a new world moth. Further down the lane, in 1900s, the beginning of 1900s, Bethier showed that Autographa sp showed cannibalism even when there was adequate food supply, showing that cannibalism was directly not a response to shortage in food, at least in that species. More recently, experiments by Dr. Chapman showed that cannibalism in fall armyworm was linked with population density, and he noticed that the impacts of cannibalism was mostly negative in nature. He noticed more mortality, less weight gain, and so on. The earliest predictions of the benefits of cannibalism was more along the ecological lines. It was seen to be a measure of population control, and it was believed that cannibalism was simply a behavior that was to make sure that the competition was reduced as more caterpillars were eaten by the conspecific. To the point, in my discussion with Dr. Dowd of USDA, he mentioned that each ear of corn only showed one mature corn earworm, even though like there were hundreds of eggs laid on that leaf. In 2014, a study by Dr. Masters showed that Asia caterpillars showed cannibalistic tendency when it faced a choice between nicotine-less dye and another caterpillar. That was the first I came across a paper that clearly laid down that caterpillars chose cannibalism as a response of avoiding plant defenses. In 2017, Dr. Orok also showed that Spodoptera exigua, which is a congenitive species to Spodoptera fujiparda, turned cannibalistic in presence of methyl jasmonate in the plant. I performed two different bioassays, actually three different bioassays, to get all the data that I needed. The first bioassay was designed to test whether cannibalism took place when there was presence of nicotine and trypsin inhibitor. And for that, I put 1/16-star larva on a petri dish with artificial diet with or without nicotine. It was 10 replicates for each treatment. I observed it for 48 hours. And for the cannibalism, I put 3 caterpillars of similar size with, it was 4 milligram per gram amount of nicotine in each artificial diet. I also repeated the same experiment with trypsin inhibitor, only increased the observation period to 68 hours. As you can see in the picture here, in nicotine set, you can see the diet is almost intact and they are eating on each other. On the other hand, the picture in the control cannibal set, you see all 3 caterpillars are very much alive and they are quite big and there is no diet left. Let me show a video of cannibalism in action. So as we can see here, they are avoiding the diet. Even the caterpillar that is on the diet is actually not eating it, while one caterpillar is starting to eat the other. And from all of my experiments with cannibalism, I have seen that this is pretty much how it goes every time. The caterpillar that becomes the predator starts attacking prey's lower gut area. It goes on for a long while, like takes hours for one cannibalism to be complete, and pretty brutal. Interestingly enough, the rate of cannibalism corresponded directly to how much diet was consumed by the caterpillars. This was the amount of diet consumed by caterpillars for the first 48 hours. And as you can see, nicotine had the least amount of diet consumed. I gave them 2 gram of artificial diet at the beginning. And so while you were seeing the 2 gram, it means that not even the first cube was completely eaten. I measured it when I put it in initially, but I did not measure the remnant, which is why I counted it at complete 4, like complete 2 gram. In trypsin inhibitor, it required on average 2 cubes of diet, while in control, it was 4 cubes. And we can see the effect of that in here. When we are looking at the rate of cannibalism, we can see that cannibalism in nicotine, which is the blue line, is much, much higher than the cannibalism in control group, which is the gray line. In this experiment, I actually recorded cannibalism in all 10 replicates of the nicotine set. And as you can see, that cannibalism increases quite steadily over time. Overall, the rate of cannibalism in nicotine treatment was 5 times that of the control. We did the similar thing with trypsin inhibitor, and here also we can see a very similar outcome, as the overall rate of cannibalism in trypsin inhibitor was close to twice that of the control cannibals. And you can see that with increased time, the rate increases pretty much linearly. I then performed a second bioassay to particularly evaluate how cannibalism impacted the growth of fall armyworm. For this, I used second instar caterpillars in three treatments. The first treatment had one caterpillar in artificial diet only. The second treatment had one caterpillar on artificial diet with 0.4 milligram of nicotine per gram of diet. And the third treatment had one caterpillar on diet with 0.4 milligram per gram of trypsin inhibitor. This was done to ensure that the caterpillars, because they were smaller, did not die of the toxicity directly. Because as you might have noticed that the previous bioassay, I had 10 times the concentration of the toxin. But that was done in 6 instars, so I did not want to risk them die off. To particularly check the impact of cannibalism, I put two caterpillars without changing the treatment. So there were in total 6 different treatments. There was individual caterpillars reared on control diet, individual caterpillars reared on trypsin inhibited diet, and individual caterpillars reared on nicotine diet. And then there were 2 caterpillars for control diet, 2 caterpillars on trypsin inhibitor, and 2 caterpillars on nicotine. These I marked as cannibalism group. They were incubated at 30 degrees Celsius for 6 days, and I took record of daily rate of cannibalism. Here also you can see cannibalism in action. The one on top is a sample from nicotine, and the second one is from trypsin inhibitor. And with caterpillars, it was a little bit easier to see that usually the bigger caterpillar preyed on the smaller one. Here also we can see nicotine caused the highest amount of cannibalism with 14 instances of cannibalism out of the 20 replicates. Trypsin inhibitor was a close second with 11 instances out of 20, and in control I only saw 4 instances of cannibalism. This basically suggested to me that the presence of the plant defenses strongly influenced the cannibalistic behavior. And I also saw that as the caterpillars grew bigger, the rate of cannibalism grew, which was easiest to evaluate here because I grew them from second instar to fully sixth instar. However, it was interesting to see that cannibalism significantly compensated for the weight gain of the caterpillars. As we can see, the nicotine individual caterpillars significantly less than the control individual caterpillar. This was measured by Tukey HSD. And on the other hand, we can see that none of the other groups are significantly different when there is cannibalism going on. But more importantly, cannibalism in presence of trypsin inhibitor gave the highest weight of all groups, which was a little bit surprising to me because I expected the individual caterpillars on control to have the highest weight, which did not happen. After the bioassays were done, I switched to gene expression assay to actually evaluate which genes were being influenced by cannibalism and the presence of toxins. This is a brief overview of the method. First, I extracted total RNA from caterpillars using the triazole method, where I put an individual caterpillar in 1 ml of triazole and ground it up until like most of the tissues were grounded up properly. Then I added 0.2 ml of chloroform to it. I vortexed it to make sure that it was properly mixed. Then I centrifuged to RNA out of the protein and the DNA mixture. It basically appeared as a clear layer on the triazole tube. Then it was added with isopropanol of equal volume and placed in ice for about 30 minutes. Then one more round of centrifugation to get the RNA pellet, which then I dissolved into RNA-free water. the RNA samples were considered to be of good quality when the nanodrop reading was between 1.8 to 2, and then they were diluted to ensure a roughly equal amount of concentration using the RNHP water, which then I converted back to cDNA using cDNA's kit. This used the reverse transcriptase enzymes to transcribe RNA into cDNA. The cDNA concentrations were then normalized once again to ensure for equal amount of cDNA concentration for the qPCR analysis, which was done to measure the gene expression of selected genes. We focused on digestive enzymes, particularly protease enzymes, and detoxification and defensive genes. The results of these are, as you can see here, this is for the nicotine treatment group. I had total 3 treatment groups that I compared against each other. I had control nicotine without cannibalism and nicotine with cannibalism. The controlled cannibalism showed no cannibals from the first bioassay, which was when this qPCR was done. So I could not use that as another group of comparison. As we can see here, it is mostly so presence of nicotine downregulated or rather repressed the expression of majority of the protease enzymes, with the sole expression sole exception being thymotrypsin, where it was significantly upregulated, significantly increased its expression. And other than alkaline phosphatase, in all of them, cannibalism increased the expression. While in trypsin, that change was not significant, it was significant in cathepsin like L-cysteine protease and chymotrypsin. And I also tested 2 carbohydrate digestive enzymes here, 1H and GOX. GOX did not show any significant difference across all 3 treatments. However, 1H, as you can see, is significantly upregulated in presence of cannibalism when there is nicotine present. I also checked the detoxification and immune-related gene expressions. For that, we selected carboxyl esterase, propanol oxidase, BLL2, and glutathione S transferase. BLL2 and propanol oxidase are the immune-related genes. They both play a role in bacterial resistance in caterpillars. And we see quite an interesting outcome here. For propanol oxidase, we see that a significant increase when there is cannibalism in presence of nicotine. But in BLL2, we actually see a significant decrease in presence of cannibalism. I do not yet know how this plays with each other, but it's interesting to see that cannibalism on one hand can or the defense against microbes, but at the same time, lower it on another gene. And BLL2 is basically a binding gene, which gives partial resistance to a wide variety of bacteria. So there is a possibility that it actually makes the caterpillar more susceptible to new microbes. However, I am more interested with the carboxyl esterase and glutathione S transferase. As you can see, glutathione S transferase is increased significantly when there is cannibalism going on in presence of nicotine. And there was a previous experiment done that showed that caterpillars that survived in presence of nicotine, they actually showed a higher expression of glutathione S transferase, which in turn made them quite a bit resistant to a wide variety of insecticides. Carboxyl esterase is also showing a similar trend and similar outcome was looking for that as well. The results of the protein digestive genes are a lot clearer with trypsin inhibitor treatment, which makes sense because trypsin inhibitor is a direct serine protease inhibitor, which is supposed to increase the production of the caterpillar's enzyme to compensate for this inhibitor. As we can see here, in trypsin inhibitor group without cannibalism, trypsin was massively overexpressed. To the point, the relative fold difference is close to 1600 times. When there was cannibalism going on, this matches with the control treatment. In case of chymotrypsin, once again, presence of trypsin inhibitor without cannibalism increased the expression to be 20 times that of the control group. And while presence of cannibalism did not fully restore it down to the control level, it still pretty much halved the expression. Cathepsin L-type cysteine protease also showed the similar trend as that of trypsin, with only trypsin inhibitor without presence of cannibalism increasing the expression massively, and when there is cannibalism, it is very much similar to the control group. In defensive and detoxification genes, we see the similar trend as we saw in case of nicotine treatment, suggesting that the cannibalism is the key driver of the behavior that we are seeing here, or rather the toxins do not vary that much of their impact. And just like before, we can see that carboxyl esterase and glutathione esterase is significantly upregulated, as is propanol oxidase. So that leads me to my conclusions. There is ample evidence for my hypothesis that presence of plant secondary metabolites induce cannibalism in fall armyworm. We also saw benefit to the caterpillars in terms of providing a new nutritional source of diet, not just by the gene expression changes, but also by the fact that caterpillars that cannibalized each other had a higher weight gain than caterpillars that didn't when in presence of these secondary metabolites. However, we also saw cannibalism impact the defensive genes. In particular, propanol oxidase can have both positive and negative impact, because propanol oxidase regulates the melanization process. Excessive melanization will always lead to the caterpillar dying. However, there is also some other reports that suggest that increase in propanol oxidase can actually increase the lifespan. I do not yet know the level that we are seeing will be positive or negative. And with that, I would like to acknowledge Dr. Dowd of USDA for helping this research with the caterpillars. I am really thankful to Dr. Musser for introducing me to this world of plant-animal interaction. I am very thankful to Dr. Hammasar for helping me with UPCR and Dr. Apitili for being part of my committee. I am especially thankful to the members of the plant animal interaction class for helping me with the research. And you can see here two other members of the plant animal interaction class just helping me with it. With the bioassays, without their help, it would have been really difficult to take detailed weights and measure the cannibalism. And with that, any questions? Thank you.
So if it closes, I guess we just reopen the meetings, as I understand from Sue. We can go ahead and open it up for questions, particularly for Dr. Meager, who's our guest from outside the committee.
I'll just ask a quick one because I have another meeting. One question I wrote down, and you said something about it, is so there's cannibalism, it happens. Do you know anything about like attributes of the animals that are the winners? Like, did you have masters or, yeah, so who's likely to win when you put three caterpillars together?
So for the first one, I actually did not see much of a weight difference between them because we put all similar sizes. However, one thing I did notice is caterpillars, when they feed on nicotine-less diet, they tend to shrink within themselves. And usually the caterpillar that first fed on the diet ended up being eaten. On the second bioassay, maybe because it was a much lower concentration of nicotine, I did not see that shrinking effect, but rather the caterpillar that was bigger almost always ate the smaller one.
Okay. Good luck. I have to go. Bye, everybody.
Thank you, Dr. Meagher. Nice. Maybe this would be a good time for a 5-minute break, and then we'll since it's going to close anyway. And then we'll open it up again, and we'll have our keep your presentation back up when you come back, meet Rajiv. Yeah. That way we can ask you some more questions, because obviously we all have some for you.
I don't know if we can open the same link. We'll try, but if not, then you may have to do a quick send out another link or something like that, maybe through Google.
Maybe I just stay in the link and see what happens.
Yeah.
I can just stay here, like keep it open.
That's fine.
And it so let's allow you
back to come back in 45. Does that sound okay for everybody? I'll give you a 10-minute break, and I'll see what I can do on my end too.
Okay.
Okay, see you soon. Okay, so I'm gonna close it and then and see if I can reopen it.
Okay.
I don't understand why I wouldn't just say, I'm gonna stop the recording. Why does it